Most interviews with film stars these days take place in anonymous hotel rooms. But by meeting with the leading lady of Dina, one of the most beautiful, funny and heartbreaking romances you will see on the big screen this year, takes place on an open-topped tourist bus. "I'm a diva, I'm sassy," Dina Buono tells me, matter-of-factly, as we clamber up to the top deck, clutching our tees, for a jaunt around the autumnal splendor of London. Buono, from Philadelphia, hasn't been in London since the mid-80s, and she wants to take in as much of the city as she can while on a promotional tour for the film that bears her name and won the Grand Jury Prize at the Sundance Film Festival this year. "I'm 50 and I'm into the menopause," she goes on to tell me with a candor most people would balk at. "But I feel like I am really coming into my own." Facing the future, Dina even finds humor at the dentist. This is Buono's first role, but it is one she has been waiting to play her whole life. The documentary, which opens in UK cinemas tomorrow and follows the run-up to her marriage with her fiancé, Scott Levin, in September 2015, shows Buono fearlessly sharing a pivotal moment in her incredible life in a film that turns conventions on its head. "I'm a big fan of the Kardashians. It's my guilty pleasure," Buono tells me as she discusses her lifelong love of film and TV and her teenage aspirations to be an actress. But the film is unlike any kind of reality TV or Love Is Land-style coupling that we have become used to watching. Instead, Dina follows the quotidian life of the couple as they prepare for their big day. We see them going on dates into the cinema, having their engagement party and, in Buono's case, a raucous hen night. Buono helps Levin move into the flat she has lived alone in for the 20 years since her first husband died of cancer. Levin has never lived with anyone but his parents before. The cameras record the bus journey that music-obsessive Levin takes to his Walmart job every morning and Buono having coffee with her mother. It shows tender moments of romance, comic interactions and painful revelations of Buono's past, when she was stabbed violently by a former lover, as they negotiate their new intimacy. Date night. Dina and Scott go to the movies. There are no interviews to camera or jerky handheld shots. Rather, the action unfurls slowly with a gentle, sunlit beauty, framed as if it were a feature film in wide shots or static moments, with soft background music created by the actor Michael Cera. It looks so gorgeous and the dialogue is so funny and perfectly timed that you feel as if you were watching a quirky indie rom-com rather than a documentary. The director, Dan Sickles, who made the film with Antonio Santini, says we're so used to seeing constant action jump shots. We wanted the film to unfurl slowly, to give Dina the space to tell the story from her perspective rather than ours. This method involved them observing the couple's routines intensely over a year and a half and shooting nearly 550 hours of film. This access, and Buono and Levin's ease in front of the cameras, was down to the long-standing relationship between the director and his subject. Sickles and Santini, who met at New York Film School, had just finished their first documentary, 2014's Mala Mala, which told the story of 9 members of the Puerto Rican transgender community. Sickles' mother and father died within months of each other and the director moved back to their Philadelphia family home to sort out their belongings. While there, he decided to start making a film about the Abington Action Club, a center for neurologically diverse adults which his father, Edward Sickles, a special educational needs teacher, had set up. Dina directors Antonio Santini and Dan Sickles' photo by Astrid Stewart's Getty Images. Buono, a student of Edward's and member of the club, where she met Levin, had known Dan since he was a baby. "Ed was a teacher, a mentor, a therapist and a father figure to me," Buono tells me. "After high school I was working in a terrible job at the YMCA where they bullied me and Ed rescued me and said, 'Come and look after my children.' He saw that I had more potential. When Buono told Sickles she was getting married again, he knew that she should be the subject of his film. Dina's story was just waiting to be told. If it wasn't me then it would have been someone else," the director says, laughing. This closeness allowed Buono and her fiancé to feel at ease in front of the camera, and to talk frankly about sex and intimacy. In one hilarious scene, we see Buono hand Levin, who is a virgin, the joy of sex, trying to express her need for greater physical closeness from him as he struggles to overcome his anxieties. "I've been around," she tells him, as she asks whether he masturbates when he thinks about her. "People don't think people on the autistic spectrum should talk about sex," Buono says to me. "They believe all these myths about autistic people. That they don't like physical touch or closeness and they shouldn't have sex." Give a little tenderness. Dina and Scott kiss goodbye on the steps of his parents' house. Buono, who works as an autism advocate and gives lectures on the subject, says she has been trying to fight the labels imposed on her since she was born. "I want this film to show that we are not like that. that we have feelings and emotions the same as everyone else. I was diagnosed with Asperger's, but I also have anxiety and depression and post-traumatic stress syndrome. The labels change all the time. That's why I prefer to use the term neurodiverse, because we can be all sorts of things. The film, As Sickles and Santini Stress, is not about explaining autism, but about the indomitable spirit of Bruno herself. We didn't want to medicalize it or make a cutesy film about autism, Sickles says. People come out of watching Dina saying, oh, they are just like me, but we wanted to show that maybe we should try to be more like them. Why should Auntie Dina and Scott be role models for us? Santini, Bruno and Sickles at the 2017 Sundance Festival. Photo by Emma McIntyre. Getty Images for Sundance. The tender consideration of the couple towards each other, and their willingness to communicate difficult thoughts and feelings with honesty, is inspirational. In the most beautiful scene in the film, Bruno takes Levin to see the ocean for the first time. As she bravely sits on the beach in her leopard print swimsuit, Scott gives her a look of smitten love and adoration that blows away anything Ryan Gosling could do. 2 years down the line in their marriage, Bruno, who has left Levin at home to look after their cat, complains about the typical things any couple would, including her husband's reluctance to do any housework. She talks excitedly about the opportunities for more acting that she hopes the film will open up, and how she is writing a book. I know Scott would support me if we moved to Hollywood, she says. Head, come with me. At the end of our interview, she asks me to be kind about her, and I am reminded that behind her calm confidence, Dina's life has been one of facing down prejudices and cruelty and dealing with the grief and the aftermath of her horrendous attack. When I ask her what she is most proud of in the film, she says that I could cry on camera and then pick myself up and carry on. That I have that resilience. Dina opens in cinemas tomorrow.